Hi, I'm Don Samulack, President, U.S. Operations of Editage, and I'm here today at Wolters Kluwer in Philadelphia talking with Dr. Ann Woods, Chief Nurse, and Shawn Kennedy, Editor-in-Chief of the American Journal of Nursing. Thank you for being here.
So hi there.
This is a one of a series of video vignettes that we've been exploring different aspects of publishing. And so we thought we'd sit down today and talk in this video a little bit about the deceptive practices that are taking place in publishing, whether it be on the publisher side of things or on the actual the author services side of things, and things that authors should be worrying about when choosing a journal to publish in or in choosing an author service to help them work on their manuscript. And so let's start by discussing how to identify a good, valid, ethical publisher.
Well, I just want to say, you know, back in the days when journals were print only, you didn't really seem to have this issue because the journal was not as discoverable, the content wasn't as discoverable, the author's name wasn't as discoverable. Now that everything is digital, anyone can find your name if you're an author, and I think that's where a lot of these dishonest, deceitful publishing houses or conferences have really been able to get into and take advantage of people when they shouldn't be doing that. So I'm going to ask Shawn, because she's had some experience with some of these deceitful publishers, her experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, at AJN we do get a lot of submissions from papers from different authors, and we also get a lot of queries. I get a lot of invitations to write articles in botany, in subjects that I know nothing about, and we've had a lot of authors who also get who publish in AJN, and then they say, "Oh, someone called and asked me if I would publish a similar article. Is that okay with you?" And I say, "Well, where is it going to be?" And they say some strange journal, like the Journal of Nursing and Care, or something that has just the title seems off. And I'll ask, "Well, who publishes it? I never heard of it. And does it have an impact factor? And where is it listed?" And it turns out that many of these journals that no one ever heard of belong to what people call, you know, either predatory publishers, which are really deceptive and irresponsible publishers who are really taking advantage of new authors who don't know the ropes and don't know the journals. So the open access model that now has changed the publishing business model, where authors are paying, really kind of drove this. And people found a way to make some money off this without having to really participate in appropriate publishing and moving academic publishing forward. So what I would say to new authors who are looking to figure out where to publish their paper is, number one, go to your university librarian. Librarians know the journals, know the works, and will help you figure out which journal is the best place for your content. Because if you're looking for research, you don't want to perhaps do a clinical practice journal. If you're looking for a clinical review article, then you might stay away from research. But again, seek out the librarian. The other place that people can go to is there's a movement that came out to counteract some of these deceitful publishers called Think Check Submit, and it's thinkchecksubmit.org, and that has a listing as well. The International Academy of Nursing Editors has a page on their site, which is nursingeditors.org, that lists publishers that list the credible journals, I should say. Journals that are listed in the index, the Thompson Index, certainly and have impact factors. Those are reputable journals. But again, you have to be careful because some of these deceptive journals now have these fake impact factors and fake metrics. So I would say the first choice is go to the librarian and then do the homework on, you know, who are the names on the editorial board, who are the other authors, see if you can know anybody else who's published with them, and really do some homework on these sites.
So the sad thing is that publishing historically has been built on a foundation of trust, and the academic trust is now being chipped away and eroded by scams, spams, and email spam, and deceitful people who are quite honestly corrupt in their intent, in that they are trying to solicit money from authors and lead them down a path where they're either publishing in a bogus journal or they are being taken advantage of in one way or another, financially or career-wise. This erosion of trust is literally turning into an erosion of trust in the literature, in the sense that we now have papers alongside other papers, and it's very hard to tell whether which paper is real research, because it has either been fraudulently derived data or it has been a just a pure bogus machine-generated paper that has snuck through peer review and has not yet been retracted. So there is an erosion of trust in the literature, an erosion of public trust, which is very concerning. And so, like Think, Check, Submit as a movement, there are other movements as well. The Coalition for Responsible Publication Resources is a recent and upcoming initiative that is a coalition of publishers and author services and other stakeholders in the publishing realm, including universities. So I guess the take-home message, and we can talk a little bit more about it, is that the author really now needs to be guarded and be very aware that they're not being taken advantage of. If, in fact, they get an email that praises them on a recent paper that they submitted somewhere else, they should really take a step back and question why this company or this publisher actually sent this email. Is the email real? Is the publisher real? Is there misintent behind this? Is there corruption involved? And really start asking questions that they haven't had to ask before.
And Don, I think it goes even more beyond, further beyond publishing. It goes into conferences and different symposia. I know Shawn and I both speak at conferences, and we've both been solicited by conferences that are not true conferences. And as you read what they're giving you, they've asked you to invite you to present, they want you to pay them $5,000-$6,000. And a reputable conference doesn't ask you to do that. So I think it really behooves anyone, whether they're an author or speaker, and many authors are speakers, to really do their homework and look to make sure it's a reputable conference before they agree to any of this.
So in fact, I'm aware that there are actually ghost conferences where you have a corrupt intent company setting up five or six conferences in a hotel room at a given day,
right?
And they say you don't have to come to present, you just have to submit your paper, all it costs is ABC, and the question is whether these conferences ever actually take place, and it is really just a money-making scheme on behalf of someone's.
Well, they take registrations and get people to you know, send in money, and there are a couple of telltale ways that I think that you, if you really start to understand conferences, or if you have some experience with conferences or even publishing, for example, for if an author gets an invitation that says, that talks about rapid peer review, a two-week turnaround, or we can publish your manuscript within a month. There's no way a good, solid peer review and vetting and clinical checking and revising can happen within a month. I had an invitation, I use it when I do a talk. I had an invitation, it was January 15th, and they said they could publish it February 1st, and I was just amazed at that. The other thing with the conferences is that the conferences, most reputable conferences are built around a theme or a specialty, and these deceptive conferences seem to be a smattering of all sorts of specialties, and they pick and choose articles or titles that are really very specialized and have no relation to one another. So that's one of the ways that people can look and see if this is, it just doesn't feel like a real conference, because it may have a neonatal topic with an oncology or geriatric topic, and it's just this, they're trying to appeal to everyone, and real conferences don't do that.
So the in the end, it's author beware.
Yes, and, very much.
And speaker beware.
And speaker beware. The sad thing is careers are really being hurt by this. There are studies now about predatory publishers and analyzing where the authors are within these bogus journals, where these papers are being submitted from. And surprisingly, while a lot of it is from India and China and Asia in general, there is a surprising percentage, 20 to 30%, that comes from North America, Europe. And so these are people who we would assume not to be taken advantage of, and that they should be aware, but they are not. And and the pride gets in the way in that you are being asked to submit your research to a journal that, especially for a young researcher, that's attractive. And we haven't talked about bogus editorial boards, and
right.
these bogus journals actually use your name, whether you you know of it or not, and the editorial board that they portray as being real, or the peer review processes they mm-hmm. portray as being real, is pure smoke and mirrors.
Mm-hmm. And we just had, and I've had experience with some very very significant people in very significant positions here in the U.S. whose names are well known to nursing circles. One of whom emailed me and said, "Gee, I was just asked to be the editor of this special issue on such and such, and I knew that there was no such journal. And then when I looked to see who the publisher was and did some checking, I realized that they were trying to traffic on this person's name. And we just had a reviewer who had agreed to be editor of a special edition of the journal, and we said, you know, do you know this publisher? And we looked, and it was a publisher that had been listed or suspected of being what they call a predatory publisher. And so people in key positions here in the U.S. aren't really aware of this, and I think the word is just getting out. The International Academy of Nursing Editors did a special project to write editorials, and many of the editors wrote editorials in their journals, and they have a site now on the Inane website that does list the journals and does talk about the different practices that people should be aware of. But it's really, we still need to get to faculty who can then talk to their students. But it's still at that level where even faculty members don't really understand it.
And what happens that people don't realize is you can be submitting to one of these deceptive journals. These deceptive journals don't archive their work. They can disappear tomorrow, mm-hmm. and that paper vaporizes.
Mm-hmm.
And because it has technically been in the literature, it can't be republished.
Right.
And so that research has... Mm-hmm. The researcher is basically hand-tied that they can no longer disseminate
right.
that paper any other way. And quite honestly, these deceptive and or predatory journals are not... We were talking about earlier in one of the other videos about dissemination and discoverability.
Mm-hmm.
These journals are not spending the effort and the time and the money in order to ensure search engine optimizations and other
right.
things in order to make your work discoverable. So it's a lose-lose-lose scenario as
is.
Opposed to a win-win scenario for the author that is caught up in one of these scams.
And even if the paper gets published in some of these journals, because some of these journals have maintained some longevity and are publishing, the author... In attempting to use this as a, here's my work, citations, here's where I published, publishing in these journals aren't going to count for anything because it's just kind of a rubber stamp. So for people who are looking to publish to enhance career advancement or to get tenure, this isn't going to do it, rapid publication in these places. And at first it might seem attractive because it seems, oh, I can get it out there quickly, and it's not going to, it's easy, and I'm guaranteed they'll publish, they'll work with me on it. And we had, as an example of this, I had an email last week where we were chuckling because they offered authorship services and creative content enhancement as appropriate. So as an editor, I wondered what that actually meant, but it was a little scary to read that. So these are deceptive places that offer services. Not only are they trying to publish the paper, but then they proclaim that they can offer services to help the author, and they're basically either rewriting it or just, you know, leaving it
but
as is.
But I think
is.
It goes all back to the idea of that if you're an author, you need to look for a reputable journal, a reputable author service to help you, and make sure you're working with a reputable publishing
mm-hmm.
house, such as like a Wolters Kluwer. And only then are you really protected and your intellectual property is protected.
And notably, Wolters Kluwer also has an author service at wkauthorservices.com. So with that, I'll bring closure to this segment of our discussion. And again, I'll mention that I'm Don Samulack, the president of U.S. Operations of Editage. And I'm here at Wolters Kluwer in Philadelphia talking with Dr. Ann Woods, the chief nurse, and Shawn Kennedy, editor-in-chief of the American Journal of Nursing. Thank you. Look for more videos.